We kick off with Lieutenant Palamas giving a report to Kirk that she's worked on all night, which has his attention for all of 8 seconds, after which Scotty shamelessly hits on her. Kirk and Bones can't help but discuss this.
One day she'll find the right man, off she'll go, out of the service.
Mm-hmm.
Or she can stay up all night powdering baby butts instead of wasting her talent writing scientific papers about alien planets. They're approaching the ridiculously named Pollux 4, a planet that Spock sums up as being pretty ordinary, although most planets do not have a giant green hand. Even Ego just has a face. Is this your card? Spock confirms this is not a literal hand, but a field of energy, and it is intent on grabbing the saucer, regardless of ideas of personal space. After the titles... Oh, you waved away my concerns, but I warned you someday we could be grabbed and thrown like a frisbee. They scramble into action, trying to figure out a way to break free, and naturally failing, on account of there's not a whole lot of protocol for dealing with a giant space hand.
Lieutenant, relay our position and circumstances to Starbase 12 immediately.
And let them know there is nothing funny about this. I don't want a repeat of the incident when we got wedged into that giant orange space butt.
Captain, a most curious development on scanner 5-7.
It appears to be wiping a large booger on us, Captain. A face soon appears, saying cryptic stuff about the past and calling them his children, you know, weird stuff like that.
We shall remember together. We shall drink the sacramental wine. There shall be the music of the pipes.
Sacramental wine? Jim, I say we at least hear him out. Well, Kirk is not going to put up with his ship being held in someone else's power, especially if they are doing so with a big green hand. But his demands to be released are met only with the being squeezing the ship tighter until Kirk is forced to cry uncle. With that, the entity tells Kirk to pick some of his officers and come down for a chat. And lo and behold, they find... a Las Vegas wedding chapel. The guy's sitting there, thankfully keeping his legs closed. You don't pick that as your outfit and then throw on a pair of tidy whiteys underneath.
Once I stretched out my hand, and earth trembled, and I breathed upon it, and spring returned.
I sneezed, and the dragons fell out of the sky. Sorry about that.
Yeah, just look at that big fat liar. Think he plays that liar very often? It's just so huge. He claims to be none other than the Greek god Apollo, despite Bones' readings that he's just a humanoid. Apollo explains that he and the rest of the Pantheon traveled to the stars until they settled on Earth 5,000 years ago, and now that humanity's out here, they can pick up right where they left off, what with the worshipping and the awe and the all that. But Kirk is not impressed.
But you're no god to us, mister.
I said you would worship me.
And you've got a lot to learn.
And so have you. Let the lesson begin.
No tidy whiteys. I knew this would happen. After a while, he fades away, and everyone wonders what to make of this. So, falling back on the old false god protocol, it's time to go searching for the power source that allows it. Look for a box that says Miracles Are Us on the side. Kirk suspects that this poorly dressed being might be the Apollo of legend, but gets interrupted by the big goofball's return.
I want from you that which is rightfully mine.
I loaned Theseus my power tools and he never brought them back.
Palamas, who knows her mythology, can't understand why he's being such a possessive asshole, presuming that the Enterprise crew's lives are his to toy with or snuff out.
You seem wise for a woman.
You're awfully brave when there are no goddesses around. Yes, you are wise for a woman, as low as that bar is. Athena's not behind me again, is she? Last time she hit me on the back of the head and my laurels went flying into the toilet.
But Apollo lays on the charm, and Scotty doesn't take kindly to some jumped-up magician making the moves on Palamas, and soon pulls his phaser on him. Seems a little bit of overkill, but anyway, it doesn't matter because it's soon destroyed, and Apollo wrecks all the other ones for good measure. She, on the other hand, gets a new dress, one that seems designed specifically with wardrobe malfunctions in mind. Scotty is aghast and tries to stop Apollo from leading her away, only to get another ass-whooping for his trouble.
How do you feel, Scotty?
Oh, it'll take me at least 6 hours to reroute the... whatever you want. Oh, make it 8.
When Scotty gets back up, ready for round 3, Kirk tells him to knock that shit off and act like a professional. While up on the Enterprise, Spock tries in vain to get some kind of headway. No dice. They are stuck, and they can't even use most of their equipment. So Sulu is going to be scanning the entire planet manually, while Uhura has to crawl up her workstation's asshole to try and figure out how to make it work again. Down on the planet, Apollo is talking about the good old days. They showed up, they impressed the locals, got worshipped, turned women into deer and had sex with them. Great times. But as they started to get forgotten, they decided to return here and began to just sort of dissipate.
Hera was first. She stood in front of the temple and spread herself upon the wind. Thinner and thinner. Until only the wind remained.
And the fresh scent of lavender. While he makes the moves on Palamas, Scotty and Chekov report there's a pulsing energy source around here somewhere, and Chekov thinks Apollo might use it like an electric eel. His example, not mine. Though I can certainly see the comparison. Apollo demands that they worship him as their god.
You want us to bow down, your god?
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
But while he's ranting about them, Apollo looks pretty exhausted, and then fades away. As for Scotty...
How do you feel?
I can't get my arm to move.
And that's my drinking hand. Lucky I have my other drinking hand. And my drinking toes, too. Chekov shares his observation about Apollo, so Kirk figures they can use that against him. Get him good and pissed off so that he uses up his power and becomes vulnerable.
Trouble with overworking him is that it can get us killed.
If we can provoke him so that he strikes one of us again, there's a chance that he'll be drained enough so the rest of us can jump him.
I still say it can get us killed.
Not all of us, Bo.
Well, that's a real glasses half full kind of look. Really channeling the Zab Brannigan there, aren't you, Kirk? In contrast, up on the Enterprise, while Spock emphasizes the importance of speed, he makes clear to Uhura his unwavering belief in her skill to do the job of rebuilding this thing, checks up on the systematic search of the planet, and offers up calculations that might allow them to breach Apollo's force field. All in all, doing pretty well. And as for down on the planet, it's da-da-da, da-da-da, time to take down Apollo, da-da-da. In the introduction to his book, Dance Macabre, Stephen King shares a story from Harlan Ellison, which includes the following line. The trouble is, he, Gene Roddenberry, can't write for sour owl poop. His one idea, done 6 or 7 times in the series and again in the feature film, is that the crew of the Enterprise goes into deepest space, finds God, and God turns out to be insane, or a child, or both. Ellison... Give me a second to look over my shoulder. He may be dead, but that only means I won't see him coming. Ellison might exaggerate slightly, but yeah, it's an overall fair assessment. I was having trouble remembering, is this the one with the interracial kiss, or was this one of the many other times they met all-powerful beings? Because after a while, it is hard to keep all these encounters with God straight. This time, we're simply removing all pretense and making it an actual God. One gets the sense that Gene Roddenberry was grinding his teeth when Kirk says,
"Mankind has no need for gods. We find the one quite adequate."
It wouldn't surprise me in the least if the network had them put that in. Please enjoy our 30-page forum thread on this issue. Well, time to make with the plan, so Kirk and company charge at Apollo and begin taunting him like a French knight, until Apollo is ready to make with the smiting. But Palamas intercedes on their behalf, spoiling the plan, Although, to be fair, she didn't know what that plan was and probably figured she was saving their lives. Since I suppose technically she did. He takes her away and then grumbles about their ingratitude towards his benevolent theocracy enforced with lightning bolts. But his charms are too great to resist, even the part about birthing a whole new race of gods. I think kids are fun, but even I wouldn't want to try babysitting that, never mind parenting the little terrors. When she returns, Kirk and her talk one-on-one about Apollo. She says, this isn't so bad. And Kirk tells her to snap out of it and do her damn job. Tell Apollo to go fornicate himself. That's what it's called when gods do it. She admits that she's fallen in love with Apollo, so Kirk makes clear that what Apollo offers is nothing less than slavery, no matter how he might want to frame it, or how much she might want to believe it when he says he just wants what's best for them. What's best for people is for them to decide, not something to be dictated to them by an authority that demands they bow and profess their love to those who place them in shackles.
We share the same history, the same heritage, the same lives. We're tied together beyond any untying. Man or woman, it makes no difference. We're human. We couldn't escape from each other even if we wanted to. That's how you do it, Lieutenant. By remembering who and what you are. A bit of flesh and blood. Afloat. In a universe without end. And the only thing that's truly yours is the rest of humanity.
Enterprise to Captain Kirk. Come in, Captain.
Kirk here. Spock here, Captain.
Oh, good. I was just telling the lieutenant that the only thing we have is the loyalty of alien friends like you. Nothing is more important to me. Spock confirms the suspicion that there's a big power source around here, and they're going to shoot it as soon as Kirk says so. But first, Palamas does the important job of breaking Apollo's heart, after Kirk reminded her of her duty as an officer.
Well, surely you know I've only been studying you.
I don't believe it. You love me.
Love you? Be logical. I'm not some simple shepherdess you can awe. Well, I could no more love you than I could love a new species of bacteria.
Oh, damn. Stone cold. Even I got a wince at that one, and I think Apollo's got it coming. Well, Apollo does not take rejection well and calls up a storm, and with all that power, Kirk figures now's a good time to shoot at the McTemple. Apollo is furious at this latest development and keeps trying to stop the Enterprise, but no matter how hard he tries and how much he yells stop, they keep it up and reduce the temple to rubble. Well, now all he can do is say to them, thanks, I offered you the bliss of living under my heel, and look how you've mistreated me. Shame on you. He calls out to the rest of the Pantheon to tell them they were right, their time is over, and then he fades away. Now that he's no longer threatening to enslave them all, Kirk can get philosophical.
Wish we hadn't had to do this.
So do I. They gave us so much. The Greek civilization, much of our culture and philosophy, came from a worship of those beings.
Buyer's remorse, huh, Kirk? Remember that the next time you slay a god. And oh, there will be so many more times. The post-episode follow-up. Annoying character goes to Scotty, though mitigated by the fact that his dumbassery keeps getting his own ass kicked. We have a cosmic faceplant award for the god Apollo, who went from being a legendary figure of worship to getting rendered impotent by a well-placed phaser blast. All scores are relative to their series. Final score for this episode is 4 out of 10. Its premise is interesting, but his old hat and TOS alone, and other episodes have just done it so very much better. There's a lot of repetitiveness to it. So much so, if you were to watch the whole thing and then I showed you a clip from it at random, I really doubt you could say which part of the episode it even comes from. It just goes round and round in a circle. And the closing conclusion is something that's always puzzled me, because it's so contrary to Star Trek, which is very humanistic and very much about human achievement. Why give credit for the culture that we created to a race of fictional beings? That doesn't seem in keeping with the show's theme at all. Of course, blowing up the temple of a false god, that sure does fit the show's theme, doesn't it?